Well, do keep your Bibles open there. It's become commonplace to treat books of the Bible as discrete texts. That is, to look at them as if they are time-bound to the people for whom they were originally written, and time-bound in terms of their place of origin, to mine them for that teaching that is considered immediately relevant to the reader today, and to disregard the way in which that text connects with the rest of the Bible and how that text has been received by the church over the 2,000 years of its history. Today, this Song of Solomon, as the title is incorrectly given to it, actually, in our Bibles. This Song of Solomon today is more likely to be peddled as a manual for marriage or as a guide to sex than it is to be something other than that, something far deeper significance. And when we come to look at the Song of Solomon, one of the things we have to bear in mind is this, that for at least 1900 of the 2,000 years of Christianity, Christian people have regarded the Song of Solomon as the most precious, the most beneficial, the most significant book in the Bible. In fact, it's been described as the Holy of Holies within the Bible by some of the greatest Christian people to have lived on the earth. And so as I come to this book, I'm very mindful of a couple of things. I'm reminded that this song is in the Bible, and that the Bible is the story of Jesus. And this evening, what we're going to look at really is the introduction. There it is. It's in the Bible, the Song of Songs. The only thing that's problematic about this opening stanza is that it may not be Solomon's. It may, in fact, be against Solomon. In other words, because the picture in this book is of a monogamous marriage, and a perfect marriage, and Solomon is not exactly noted for that. As my wife was listening to me on the way in here, she said, he was a dirty old man, and gave me this, all the reasons that we should disregard him. And I'm saying to her, well, just wait till you hear the sermon. Then she's on the nursery and she's not going to hear the sermon. So, you know, what can we do? Anyway, so I want to break down this title that's given to us here, the Song of Songs. Because I believe, and many scholars believe, that this title is in fact the introduction and the way of helping us understand what the book is about. So I've got 3 points. First of all, the Song of Songs as song, first of all, as song. Because this is not a collection of different poems, but one song, and as such, it is a unified piece of poetry. Now, let me remind you about poetry. I know some of you are scientists, and you don't get this, so I've got to explain it to you. And you may not get it even after I've explained it. But poetry is, at its best, evocative speech. It uses metaphors and images and phrases that are meant to stir the imagination, to heighten the emotions, to be aesthetically pleasing to the ear. Some forms of writing are precise, technical, and specific. Scientific writing has to be that. Precise, technical, and specific. But in poetry, it is the effect of the words that is important. The best poetry should elevate our thoughts, should have the noblest of themes as their topics. It should stir the purest emotions. It should deal with the richest ideas. It should connect with our deepest, most fundamental feelings as human beings. John Milton, the great Puritan poet, said, true poetry is simple, sensuous, and passionate. And he meant none of that in the ways in which those words may be used today. Now, when God made the world, he multiplied within the world a multitude of beautiful sounds and sights and smells and senses. When God made us humans, he made us able to enjoy and savor the beauties of those things. He made us with a love for beauty. And this song is a work of exquisite beauty. We have to say that right at the very beginning. And it's a love song, not at the level of the Beach Boys or the Beatles. This is a love song that is a creaturely reflection of the love that is God, for God is love. This song is a love song between a man and a woman. That's true. There are in the Bible songs of singleness in Matthew 19 or 1 Corinthians 7. And they're given for those who are single, widowed, or divorced to sing. But I ask you, would God put into the Bible a song such as this, a beautiful song, without something here for you, if you fall into any of those categories? I believe that there is something in this song, not only for married people, but for all of us, whatever our state and condition in life. There is something here for every Christian to think and to sing about, no matter their state. If this song were only about married love, if this song is about married love in a human sense alone, then it's about a perfect marriage. So those of us who are married will not even identify with what's in it. It's about more than marriage. It points us beyond our creaturely love and marriage, I believe, to the marriage we were made for. So it's poetry. It's a song, the song of songs as song. And then secondly, I want to consider it as scripture, the song of songs as scripture. You will notice that this song is in the Bible. Now that ought to be immediately very clearing of your head and so on. That means that this book partakes of its inspiration. It is the gift of the Holy Spirit to the church. It partakes of the Bible's perfection, because as for God, his ways are perfect. And it partakes of God's holiness. We call it the Holy Bible for a reason. It partakes of God's holiness, for God is holy. And the theme of each part of the Bible develops a storyline that goes all the way through from Genesis to Revelation, a big story, the big story of God's unfolding plan of salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ. That means that this love song, and that it is a love song, must be singing the Bible's love song of God's love for his people. Now, let me demonstrate how it does this. First of all, if you read it, I want you to think as you read it of some of the great Bible themes. James Hamilton's written a little book on Song of Solomon, which he comes at it from a biblical theological perspective, and he identifies a number of things. I'll share them with you. First of all, the setting of the book. As you read the story, you find that the action takes place mostly in a garden. It is a well-tended garden. The garden is perfectly and beautifully cared for. You read of this man and this woman. They're a perfect match for one another. There's perfect love between them and so on. You cannot read the book of Song of Solomon without an echo of Eden in your mind. In fact, the only thing like Eden in the entire Bible, until you get to the New Jerusalem, is the Song of Solomon. It reminds us of a time when women were strong, men were good-looking, all the children were above average, the Garden of Eden. Eden, before the world was cursed, the Bible says was very good. Men and women got along without any trouble. Childbirth was safe and pain-free. There was no evil, there were no enemies. Everyone would choose what was good and true and beautiful. Everybody would be emotionally intelligent as well as intellectually intelligent. That was in Eden. That was before the fall. Before the fall, women were not trying to get their husbands' love and attention. And husbands were not acting like tyrants or bosses. The land was well watered, uncursed. Men and women were naked and unashamed. Hamilton says, the closest we get to being back in the Garden of Eden in the rest of the Bible is in the poetry of the Song of Songs. The song is set in a garden and in Zion, that is the city of the king. And you know that the whole trajectory of the Bible from Eden is towards a new Eden and a new Jerusalem, the garden city that we read about in the book of Revelation. In the song, the garden is cultivated. It has this new Adam figure, this man in the story who works it and keeps it. This is what the first Adam was supposed to do and failed to do. The Bible points us regularly to this second and last Adam, the seed of the woman who would keep the garden city, Zion, and create a new heavens and a new earth. That's the setting of the song. And the plot of the song. Eden was the template, Eden, the Garden of Eden, was a template for the tabernacle and the temple, and was the place where men and women enjoyed the uncluttered presence of God in an intimate way. Eden is the only place where that has happened up to this point, where the presence of God was intimately felt by God's people. And Moses, when he receives the instructions for the tabernacle, is told to decorate the tabernacle on the inside with leaves and flowers and plants to remind people of Eden. Eden was the Holy of Holies. In fact, the language that's used of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden tending and caring for the garden is the very same language, the very same words that are used for the priests in the temple tending and caring for the temple of God. This was the place where God met with his people. It was the Holy of Holies of its day. And in the cool of the day, the Lord would walk in the garden. The Lord would meet with his people. Just the same language is used by Moses when he's talking about the Lord saying to them, saying to us, or to the people of Israel, I will come and I will walk with you. I will be with you. Build a tabernacle and I'll walk with you and I'll meet with you. In other words, Eden represents the place where God meets his people. In Eden, the man and his wife dwelt in the presence of God, and they were naked and not ashamed, we're told in Genesis 2. There was nothing crude, nothing pornographic. The relationship was pure. When we see the man and woman together, naked, flawless, perfect, worshiping without sin in the presence of God, we know that we're in the presence of the Holy. Sin destroyed that picture. Sin destroyed the idyll of the garden. They became aware of themselves in a way they'd never been before. They saw in each other's eyes something they'd never seen before. Sin destroyed the purity of the garden. That's the way things were. Now things are different today. Dirty looks and thoughts and jokes and innuendos abound throughout all of our language. We do not feel safe with each other anymore. Women do not feel safe with men because of sin. That's the reality of a fallen world. In the garden, they sensed the danger and they hid from each other. But this song foresees Adam and his bride in Eden, in a place where harmony and radiance and shining innocence reigns again. We see a son of Adam, a descendant of David, who has overcome the causes of that alienation and been reconciled to his bride. That's the plot. And the hero of the plot is this. God had promised Eve a seed, that is, offspring, one male offspring who would crush Satan. And whenever her children were born, Eve looked at her children and wondered, is this the one? Is this the one? That promise narrowed from Eve to Abraham's seed. It narrowed still to the tribe of Judah, Judah's seed. It narrowed further to David, the seed of the woman who would destroy Satan and reconcile men and women and men and men and women and women, and the world would come from David himself. He was a descendant of David, says Paul, according to the flesh. So briefly, when we look at the story, we look at the overview of the story, we think of the biblical themes that are wrapped up in the story. We see a second and last Adam, a descendant of David, who will sort out the alienation problem once and for all, who will keep this garden city that is a holy of holies, a place where God meets with his people. He will do all this in a garden and in Zion, which the Lord loves. The song, which no doubt depicts human love, sees beyond human love to the love between God and his people. So those are the biblical theological things in the scripture. But also, just for a moment, think about the placement of it in the scripture. It's placed among the writings, a group of various books in the Bible that are typified by the fact that they teach wisdom. Wisdom is the hero of those books who appears again and again. And all of those books, the writings, are thought by the scholars to be introduced by the first two Psalms. In the first Psalm, the wise man is the man who follows the law of God, reads the law of God, walks in the way of God's law, and in all he does, he prospers. In Psalm 2, wise people kiss the sun, lest he be angry. Wise people bow to the Son of God and acknowledge his right to rule and find refuge in him. They find refuge in him. All that is in Psalm 2. And those two themes pervade the writings. The idea of wisdom ultimately, the best wisdom, leading you to God, leading you to the Son of God, leading to you to God's Messiah. You find that throughout the book of Psalms. You find it in Job, as the innocent sufferer is restored to glory. You find it in Proverbs, as Lady Wisdom speaks of the Son, the King who was before all ages and who created the world. You find it in the book of Ruth. In fact, Ruth is the preeminent illustration of wisdom in the Old Testament. Ruth, this Gentile girl who leaves her home and goes with her mother-in-law back to Judah, back to Bethlehem, and who chooses to do that because she chooses to follow the God of Israel. That's the way of wisdom. She's presented as the wise person. The wise person follows God, follows the Lord God of Israel. Ruth gives us David. She's the grandmother of King David. Ruth stands in the Bible, and when you read about the woman in the Song of Songs, she looks a bit like Ruth. She's in the same spirit as Ruth. She has a heart like Ruth, and she finds her beloved. As Ruth found her beloved Boaz, so the woman in this song will find her beloved. Wisdom is the key theme then of the writings. It's the key theme of the book of Ruth, who is described as, characterized as wisdom, and is the template really for the figure in this book. So here's my third introductory point. This is all very introductory this evening. I thought if you're here, you're really keen, so you can take this. The Song of Songs as superlative. Just think about it for a moment. Look at the title again. The Song of Songs. That's a Hebrew technique of making something superlative, taking it to the nth degree. Think about it. The Holy of Holies, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Heaven of Heavens, and even vanity of vanities. It is a superlative, whether it's a bad thing like the vanities or a good thing like the Heaven of Heavens or the Holy of Holies or the Lord of Lords or the King of Kings. The very use of the expression here is unheard of anywhere else in the Scripture. It is being pushed into the category of the superlative. And the title tells us that this is the best song there is. This is the very best song you will ever sing. It's in the inscription. That's how we're to interpret the song. Brian Twos, in his paper on the Song of Solomon, makes much of this. He does his research into this. He gets us to think about this song in the Bible, and he asks, what song in the Bible would be called the best song ever? Would there be a song in the Bible, the best song that you could ever sing in your life, if it was only about love and marriage? Love and marriage. I mean, we've got other songs about love and marriage. We don't need Song of Songs there. Would the best song that you can sing in your life be a song about love and marriage? How would people who are not married feel? How would people who are in unhappy marriages feel about singing a song just about love and marriage? Would the best song you can ever sing in your life in the Bible be about the joy of sex? Not that the Bible has anything against sex. In fact, God created it, so there's nothing bad about it. But would that be the greatest theme in the Bible? Maybe we shouldn't be looking then at this book and asking the question, what's in this book for me? Is this about me or my life or anything that's going to be in my experience? Maybe what we should do as we come to this book is to think this. Is this book God-centered rather than man-centered? Is this book really the best song we can sing about God? Bernard of Clairvaux has a great book of sermons, like 100 or more sermons on the Song of Solomon. You'll be glad to know I'm not going to do 100. But Charles Spurgeon, the great Baptist preacher, has 50 sermons on the Song of Solomon, which my dear Carol has been printing out for me. These men realize this is the best song we can sing about God. Now remember, I said this song is in the Bible. You think about the songs that are in the Bible. It's being compared to all the other songs that are in the Bible. Think about some of them. The Song of Moses. The song that Moses sang when they were delivered, you remember, across the Red Sea. It was a great song of God's salvation, God's deliverance. It's an amazing song in Exodus chapter 15. Or Psalm 45, which is a marriage song, the marriage of the Messiah. It's a song about the love of the King and the love that he would bring into the world. Or you think of Isaiah chapter 5, which has as its title, a song of my beloved concerning his vineyard. It's the language of Song of Solomon. Even the Jewish Targum understood this song as being related to the other great songs of the Bible, and that what it was saying is, this song transcends all the other songs in the Bible. It is the best song, the highest song, the noblest song that you can sing. This song is called the Song of Songs because it brings us into the Holy of Holies. That's what we're going to find. It brings us into the Holy of Holies. It brings us into the presence of the one who is called the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He is the one that stands at the center of Scripture's self-revelation. Lady Wisdom in Proverbs is looking for the Messiah. This wise woman of this song is looking for her Lord and Savior, her beloved. And when we stand back a bit further from the Song of Solomon, we look to the New Testament. You go to the very back of the Bible where we read about a new Eden, a holy city, New Jerusalem, a garden city with trees of life, Zion, a bride adorned for her husband, the bride, the wife of the Lamb. The church is the bride, the wife of the Lamb, Revelation 21. When commands are being given to husbands, what are they told? Love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. When Paul's writing to the Corinthians, he says, I have betrothed you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ. And with echoes of Eden, he goes on to say, but I am afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. And Jesus said, the one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The one who has the bride is the bridegroom. The Song of Songs is the superlative song of love between the believer and her Lord. Between the believer and her Lord. Let's pray. In that communion, we sometimes sing a song by Spurgeon based on the language of Song of Solomon's, amidst us, our beloved stands. And this evening, Lord, as we gather around this table, you will be coming close to us by your Holy Spirit, as you do all the time we come to the table. And you will put into our hands those gifts that you've given to us, the bread and the wine, representing the body and the blood of our Savior. And you will kiss us. You will touch us physically. We will see and taste things unseen. We will be drawn more closely into that intimate relationship of the believer and their Lord. And we pray that you would do this for us tonight. You'd help us to see that by the Holy Spirit, who is in everything and but also indwelling the believer, the words of the Lord Jesus to his people are so full of significance to us. And he reaches out and touches us as he puts the bread and the wine into our hands. We pray that we might feed on him and love on him and adore him and dwell on him, think of him as we eat and drink in your presence tonight. In his strong name we pray. Amen.